We're going to start this second half with a bit of fun, a little bit different from a normal tutorial. We're actually going to get you interacting with each other some and thinking about how you might apply some of the things we've talked about to the LinkedIn feed ranking problem. So you'll see that there are around the room white pieces of paper on the wall, and there's markers down there as well. There should be markers at each of the stations. And so in a few minutes, we'll break away into groups, and you'll spend about 15 minutes discussing some of the considerations that I want you to think about. And then we'll come back, and you should designate a note taker, and I'll poll the audience for some of your thoughts around each of the things that you were talking about, and I'll also share how LinkedIn some of the thoughts about how LinkedIn is approaching these problems. And so in the LinkedIn feed, we have a variety of update types that show up when you use the site or the mobile application. For example, there's sponsored advertising, which has a short text, a logo, a link to a web page. We also have another example would be updates from companies that you follow. And a third example would be updates from connections. And there's a variety of actions that you can take, and you can see that for the different update types, the actions may be different. For example, in a sponsored advertising case, you might be able to follow a company, or for a update from a connection, you might be able to directly open up a message and send them a message from that connection, from that update. That's just a small sample of the number of update types that you can see in the LinkedIn feed. There's a ton of other things, and there's a huge variety of these kinds of updates, including job recommendations or recommendations about people you may know, or updates around work anniversaries for people that you're connected to. And this makes it a really interesting and challenging problem to apply predictive modeling to, that heterogeneous sort of content. And it really is important that we do a good job of ranking them to help our members have a great experience. And when we think about the update types, we refer to, we have a vocabulary for that's common across all update types, and that's actor, verb, object formalism. For example, the actor is the person or entity that did the action, such as a member in a comment or a company in a advertisement. The verb type is the action, and so that might be a connection or a share, or that they updated their profile. And the object type would be the thing that received that action. As a concrete example, in the case of a sponsored advertising post, the actor is the company, in this case, Hired Incorporated. The verb is shared, and the object is a link to their website and a text description. So when you think about the feed ranking problem, it's important to keep in mind some of these considerations about LinkedIn in general, the scale of the challenge. We have 400 million members. Some members may have thousands of items that we need to rank, and so speed is important. In this case, for the study, I want you to focus on the modeling problem. Don't worry about which items you might need to rank. That's provided by an external system. And some other things that are important to consider is that this is a ranking problem. So you might have a set of candidates for a particular member that you need to order. That may influence how you think about evaluating the model. It's an online scoring problem. It's not done in batch offline. And so speed and latency is critical. The interactions are on the items in practice are skewed. People tend to interact, like such as click or like or share or comment on things that are near the top of the feed, and that creates some bias. There's the your log data may also be biased by the current algorithm that's in place. And there's and as a reminder, there's a really diverse range of these update types. And these update types often have very different kinds of attributes, but they do all have the actor, verb, and object formalization in common. And there's always a viewer of these items. We do have a mix of advertising and organic content in the feed. And so it's really important that we think about the revenue engagement trade-off. And as such, having well-calibrated models that are accurate predictors is important. So those are some things that I want you to think about when you you form your work groups and discuss this problem. So let's take 15 minutes. So meet back. We'll sort of gather back at our seats at, let's say, 10:50. And just wander over to these different stations. We'll float around and help you get the conversation started. And let's have some fun thinking about feed ranking at LinkedIn. All right. So it looks like everyone was really engaged and there was a lot of good discussions going on. One of the things I wanted to do as part of this is just hear a few voices. I'll repeat what I hear back so that the recording can get it. But we'll start with, how would you think about formulating the problem and what kind of machine learning method might you apply to that? So who had some thoughts around that? Don't be shy. Yeah, so the observation for the very interactive group over there is that it's actually a challenge to define an objective function given the revenue engagement trade-off. That makes it an interesting and challenging problem. Did you have specific thoughts on what you might do? Yeah, that's actually a really great thought. And so the thought was that you might have a short-term metric such as click-through rate that you want to measure and optimize for, but also monitor and watch some of the long-term metrics around customer member engagement and the health of the ecosystem. And I won't go into details of some of the longer-term metrics. I will sort of focus a little bit about and share some thoughts around how we've cast it at LinkedIn. Specifically, we've chosen to cast it as a binary classification problem. I'm going to gloss over some of the subtleties of how we do it, but the basic idea is to treat the positive examples as things where there's an interaction, and the negative examples as things that were impressed but not interacted on. There's some challenges with that due to having the previous algorithm bias. And so we also collect some randomized data where for some members, we're actually randomizing the top-end results to reduce the bias in the data that we're collecting. In terms of the The revenue engagement trade-off, I'll actually touch on that again a little bit later. There's a question. I'm sorry, That's right, that's right. So the negative examples would be the things that were shown but not clicked in the random bucket data. Potentially, but you could, if you consider there's the actor verge object formalism, where that actually creates a very unique item. Now, for one member, you might actually see that item in your feed multiple times. I think in practice, what we do is if it is impressed at any point that it's been shown, and sorry, interacted with at any point that it's been shown to that member, then we'll consider it a positive example. And so that's one of the decisions you have to make and sometimes a tough decision to make, because that might not always be representative of what you actually need to predict. And so I won't go into the details of logistic regression. The other reason that it's appealing in this context is that it gives you estimates, predicted probabilities of the interaction. And that does play into the revenue engagement trade-off. And it also plays into how we evaluate the accuracy of the model. In practice, what we do is we'll actually weight the prediction by an estimate of the value of the impression, whether it's to the organic content, the value to the ecosystem, or the revenue we'd make from that. And so that allows us to trade off the revenue and engagement, but it does require accurate response prediction, or well-calibrated response prediction. What were some of your thoughts around what kinds of features you might want to use in a machine learning model for this context? Don't be shy. Yeah. Yeah. So there were certainly some in the earlier part of the talk. There were like the online behavior, the demographics, and the sort of social connection kinds of features. And in fact, you actually see that's really great observation. You'll see that some of these features fall into those categories. So this is a sample of some of the features you could use in the feed modeling problem. There's the viewer-only features, such as the member industry or geolocation, the skills. If you just include those naively into a linear model, what that will mostly capture is member or demographic bias and likelihood to interact with the feed in general. If you have activity-only features, such as the time of the activity or the verb type, that might capture certain biases. The verb type might capture certain biases towards propensities to act for people in general, members in general, to act on certain verb types, whereas the time of the activity might allow you to capture how important the freshness of an update is. We also do include in model training quite often the object-only features, such as the position that it was shown. We don't use this in the online ranking because it's not available, but what this allows us to do is capture some of the bias that's present in the training data and the click bias. You might have interaction features, such as things that are capture the interactions between a viewer and an actor, such as the number of messages sent to the actor by the viewer. So for example, if the update is a job change, then the actor would be the person who changed the job, and the feature would be how many times that viewer had interacted or sent messages to the viewer. These sort of social activity features are really predictive and very powerful how likely you are to engage with their content in other scenarios. And as another example, you might have a viewer activity type feature. So for example, this might be the click-through rate for that particular activity type, such as like or comment or share. And or you might have a viewer verb type feature, such as the how much you tend to interact with connections or advertising or member anniversaries or things like that. And so that just sort of gives you a broad flavor of the wide variety of features that you could use. Things that you might also want to consider and we're looking at but haven't made heavy use of might be the content of features, content of the updates themselves. In a regression context, as you know, and we discussed early, these raw features are often not directly usable or don't play well with the logistic regression models. And so we do the normal kinds of transformations, such as potentially taking a log of a raw count, or for other numeric features, we might look at the distribution of those features and create buckets and turn those features into binary indicator variables. The last thing that's really important in the feed ranking context is what kinds of offline evaluation you might do prior to deciding to launch a model in an online A/B test. Did anyone have thoughts around what kinds of evaluation metrics you might want to look at?
Click rate?
So the click rate we wouldn't have in an offline context. We'd have to look at that after an A/B test. AUC, that's a great one. Actually, that's the first one that we look at. And that it's often used if we've got a lot of hyperparameters to choose among. But we don't stop there. I mentioned already that it's important to have well-calibrated probabilities that are representative of the actual interaction rates. And that because we use the predicted probabilities in combination with the value of the items, and if we have predictions that tend to be skewed high or low, that may mean that we're actually not able to as accurately control the revenue engagement trade-off as we'd like. And so one measure that we look at specifically in that context is the observed over expected ratio, where the expected is the sum of the observed probabilities. The predicted probabilities in the items that we're ranking, and the observed is the actual interactions, is a one for whether those items were interacted with, and a zero if it wasn't. If this number is less than one, the model tends to overestimate the probability. If it's over one, it tends to underestimate. And we do this evaluation on held out randomized data, that is not downsampled in any way. Like in the other cases when training, you might actually downsample the negatives, but you would not do that when computing the observed over expected ratio. Lastly, there's a metric that we call internally as replay, and it's based on a Yahoo paper from a few years ago that was developed for, the metric was developed for estimating, creating an unbiased estimator in a multi-armed bandit context for advertising, but it works well in this context as well. And basically what we look at is in the randomized data, we record what items were shown at what position, and then we take, and in the offline evaluation, we'll take the new model, score and order for a particular session, we'll score and order the items according to the new model, and compare the first position in the randomized data with the first position and the data that in the new model, if they returned the same item, we record the reward, so a positive number for cases where there was an interaction and a zero for cases where there was not an interaction, and ignore the cases in the data set where there was no match. This is a high variance estimator, so you have to have enough randomized data to rely on it, but it is a reasonably unbiased estimator under certain assumptions. If it's truly random over all candidates, then it's a completely unbiased estimator. But in practice, sometimes you might actually want to randomize over the top N items, which does introduce some bias. However, in practice, we find that this metric is a really great metric to understand the cardinality, like the directionality of whether a new model might perform better than the existing model that's running. So we'd also run, you know, compute the replay metric for the existing model as well. The next part of the talk that I wanted to go through is some considerations that you may have when choosing a framework. And I noticed that from the survey that a lot of you are from industry and working in industry already. And so I wanted to do a quick poll of hands. How many of you believe in the next few months you may be making recommendations or decisions around which machine learning algorithms you might be using, or which platforms, machine learning or modeling platforms you might use? So raise your hands if you think you're gonna be faced with these decisions. Oh wow, that's a lot of people. Okay, so I'm gonna share some of my thoughts around considerations, having built machine learning algorithms and platforms for LinkedIn, and we'll give you some anecdotes about where we fall in terms of some of these decisions. But I also, when we go through after I share considerations, we're going to go through a quick survey of some of the tools that are out there that are available and some of the platforms that are available, and I do want this to be interactive, and I want to hear some of your thoughts around when I talk about a specific library or platform, around what's work if you're using it, what's working well, what you wish would be better, and so we'll try to sort of leverage our network in this context, and get some shared knowledge that's greater than just mine. The first thing that's really important is you should really consider the scale of your problem. It's actually quite common that the single machine algorithms can scale more than you realize. And so there's some numbers up there from a somewhat artificial evaluation that I stole from somebody else, and there's a reference there. But it does give a good sense of the scale of the problem. Like you can train very large models with lots of examples on single machine implementations. How many of you regularly train models that have thousands of examples or more? Tens of thousands? Hundreds of thousands? Millions? Tens of millions? Billions? So there's just a couple of hands up for billions, right? And so this example should give you a sense for like just how far you can go on a single machine. I'm not saying you need to use single machine. There's other considerations, but the single machine algorithms are often a little more robust and tested, and often come with great tools for debugging and diagnosing the models. There's also more of them available. Another consideration that's really important is how the software would integrate with your company's existing technical stack, because you're often not making these decisions in isolation of the other software systems that you'll have to be pulling data from. That could be based on the different data formats or sources, such as are you already using Kafka heavily, and you have your data serialized into Avro on your HDFS cluster, or has your data warehousing team spent time optimizing the data formats for columnar representations, and you have Parquet data available, or some other object relational columnar format? And so you want to You can certainly, for most of these tools and technologies, build your own data converters. If a particular solution that you want to use doesn't have the natively read the data in the format that your company stores it in. But I want to actually let you know that it's actually a little bit harder than you might think it is sometimes, because you often have to deal with character encoding issues, or in some of the libraries require pre-indexed features in certain orders rather than a sparse representation, which we talked about in the feature storage and feature integration part of the talk earlier. Another point of integration beyond the source of the data that you use to train your model is the how the models would get deployed and where they'd get deployed. Some of the libraries might support model export in a machine-readable format that could be loaded in other platforms. Like there's a bit of increasing support for the predictive modeling markup language, but it's not widespread or uniform yet. And some other libraries might provide embeddable scores. So pieces of code or binary that you could easily load in another application. And there you have to consider what programming languages, what binaries they provide, and whether those are compatible with the deployment environments you need to run them. If you're doing offline scoring in Hadoop, it's often very flexible. You can have a lot of choices. But if you need to deploy those models into an online service for online scoring, you need to make sure that the binaries are compatible with the company's serving tech stack. Obviously, the modeling techniques that you need are important deciding factor, although there's a lot of great libraries out there that cover a lot of the standard bases like logistic and linear regression, or random forests and gradient boost and regression trees. That said, the maturity of those solutions can vary widely from one implementation to another. The gradient boosted models or ensembles of trees can be really useful in contexts where you need to get good model accuracy without spending a lot of time on the feature engineering. They can be slow to train. They're not really amenable to retraining online if you need to do that. And they can be slower to score, although with a little bit of work, you can actually have some highly optimized tree scoring implementations. The regression models, on the other hand, they can scale to really large data sets very easily. They often come with useful model diagnostics and can be really fast at scoring. There may be other new hot techniques that are out there, such as factorization machines or deep learning. I'm not going to go much into the deep learning options or so much into factorization machines. In practice, deep learning is gaining a lot of momentum in industry in certain applications. But in the predictive modeling contexts where we're looking at search or recommender systems, it's much more common to see regression-based models or tree ensembles used in practice. Sometimes there's some interesting combinations of deep learning and these models where you might use deep learning, pre-trained deep learned models as feature generators into a regression model. Another key consideration is what kinds of scoring support the tools have. And there's two common techniques for scoring items in a production environment. One is to pre-compute the scores in batch in an offline context such as Hadoop or Spark or another MapReduce-like framework. There you typically are on your own for identifying which items in a recommendation context or a prediction context you want to score. You'd feed these into you do your feature joins and feed these into a scoring utility, rank and store them in a key value store or a database. And then online serving is a relatively straightforward task of looking up a member or a context that you need for you have for that recommendation and serving the results. That allows a lot of flexibility and quick iteration on different modeling techniques or ideas. However, it's kind of costly, especially in cases where you're computing predictions that are never accessed. The other approach is to compute things on demand, where your candidates may come from a search engine or a database query, and then do the scoring online. Their latency and the speed of the scoring is much more critical, and it requires a more robust online infrastructure. Can lead to interesting challenges in how you think about how you deploy the models, how you do the A/B testing that might be harder than in the offline context. Another dimension, a factor that you should consider is where you are fall along the build versus buy spectrum. At one extreme, you might be a small company, not have much engineering support, but you have budget and you can buy a platform solution and get support contracts and get help from a company to make customizations or help you debug why something's not working. That can work really well for small teams, but it can be limiting in terms of the techniques and tools that you have available for you. On the far other end of the spectrum is to build your own. And this, I would argue, only makes sense for when you're supporting very large teams. In fact, at LinkedIn, we still don't build all of our own solutions. We leverage other open source things in some cases. So we're somewhere in the middle. We build some of our own, but we also assemble. We also leverage open source technologies, such as we're using XGBoost some for training trees. But we might build some of our own machine learning libraries. Assembling also allows you to leverage open source technology, but filling in the gaps and making the integration with your company's tech stack a little bit easier so you can improve the productivity of the people using the tools. If you're looking at a platform or library, one thing that I think you should definitely do is consider the maturity of that platform and how risk sensitive you are. If you're not risk averse, you might actually be able to be willing to be very flexible and try the latest and greatest. But one thing you can do to understand better is the maturity of a particular platform is to leverage your network. And we'll actually do a little bit of that coming up. And ask your peers who's using it in their production systems for model training. Are you using any of the tools for that they provide for scoring items or making the predictions in an online context? How well is it working? Are they hitting any scale challenges or ease of use challenges? If you don't have a strong network, in the context of open source solutions, you can take a look at the open source project itself. Is it actively being developed? Is it being developed by multiple large companies? Where are the contributions coming from? It's usually a good sign if there's a lot of development on a particular project. However, if there's a ton of development, the latest versions of that software might still be a little unstable because things could be changing rapidly. So one common practice is to use not the latest version, but the version before the latest. Those tend to have some extra bug fixes and additional patches that help with the stability of the tools. You may also want to consider what companies are writing the software and whether they have strong engineering practices or not. If you're purchasing a solution or support from another company, consider the pedigree of the people at the company. You can look them up, do some research on them on LinkedIn, see who works there, and yeah, it's a great way to do it. Yeah, you can actually dig in and see, make your own judgments about the quality of the machine learning or modeling experts at that company. You can also, you'd also want to consider taking a look at the size of the company, how much funding they've received, to see whether they look like they're a stable company or not. The last thing that I think you should consider is that you're not always going to have exactly the same needs and requirements. So I'd encourage you to think about and anticipate your evolving needs early on in your in adding a particular tool. You might want to rely heavily on a solution, but then later transition to more of a model where you're assembling more of the components and doing a tighter integration. And so it's pretty common these days that most of the solutions are built on top of open source software, which is great. So you that helps with easing the transition from a solution to assembling. However, some solutions have varying degrees of how much of their platform is open source or not. And so the next part that I wanted to do is, you know, interact with you all a little bit and talk about some of the machine learning libraries that are used and available in industry, get some of your quick thoughts, and also some of the platforms as well. One library that's getting a lot of attention these days is Spark and its machine learning libraries. The newer ML components have some usability, ease of usability through data frames and pipelines. They've got slightly the algorithms in the ML package are a little more polished and a little more robust, but they're a little more limited on the regression algorithms and tree-based algorithms. It also has K-means and LDA. The MLlib is an older RDD-based API, but it has more things in it. One of the great things about Spark is that it has a lot of data connectivity to other data sources, and it also provides some PMML model export. How many of you are using Spark to do your machine learning? It's a lot. Okay. What are some of your thoughts around the tools, some of the libraries that are there? What's worked well for you, and what has been challenging? Sorry, with so some of the algorithms can run a little hot on certain nodes, whereas some of the other ones. Do you have a sense for which ones are well done and which ones could be better? So some of the newer implementations seem to be a little more scalable, but the earlier regression-based ones might run hot sometimes. Anybody else with thoughts or experience?
Yeah, I was going to say, I think that Spark is really easy, especially when you have something on the front end, and you
Okay, so her experience is that the data frames are actually really nice to work with, but some of the algorithm support is a little bit limited, and so there's a trade-off that they're seeing between what kinds of things you might want to try and what's currently available. Anybody have anything else they'd want to share about Spark? Okay, so his experience is that the data frames are great, but there are still some things missing important, like good parallelized support for binning features. One of the things we've also noticed at LinkedIn is that some of the tree-based algorithms don't scale as much as we'd like that are implemented there. And they know, I have friends who work at Databricks, so they have open issues around making it more columnar-based, which should speed things up a little bit. Another library that's out there that I like to use when I'm playing around with data is Vulpal Wabbit. How many of you are familiar with Vulpal Wabbit and have used it in the past? All right, there's some good people. There's some good hands there. One of the things that's great about Vulpal Wabbit is that it's really fast, and it can train crank through a lot of data points on a single machine very quickly, and it does it using the hashing trick, which will take a large sparse feature ID space and compress it down to maybe 18 bits worth of features. Trade-off there is that you're intentionally creating collisions, and so you lose some of the interpretability of the model because you're not assigning a weight to one specific feature, but to a set of features that happen to hash to the same bucket. But it's really fast, and there is a server-based implementation, so you could do some distributed training, and it has some nice tools in there for automatically just from the command line or training time to generate interaction features for you, which can help you quickly assess whether higher order features are useful. Does anybody want to share any of their thoughts of what they like or dislike about Vulpal Wabbit? No, okay. I've had fun playing around with it on my dev box. I'm not aware of many people using it in production systems. It is available in Azure machine learning platform, but it's not their standard implementation. You have to sort of specifically request it when you're configuring things. Another library that's worth noting, it's an academic largely library, but has some industrial contributions to parts of it, and it's the DMLC library. It's sort of a loose collection of libraries. Of note, I would say in particular is XGBoost, which is widely used and used some in industry. It's got scalable gradient boosted regression trees, gradient boosted machines, also random forests. And MXNet for one of the many deep learning choices out there right now. And there's also an implementation of factorization machines. The de facto library hasn't had a lot of support recently, so I'd wonder about how reliable it would be in a non-academic context. Has anybody worked with DMLC? Anything? Nope. Okay, so that's a not as a widely known library, but there's some really great stuff in there, especially XGBoost. Who uses scikit-learn? Almost as many people as Spark. That's great. What are some of the things you love about scikit-learn? The documentation is good. When I read through it, I was pretty impressed too. It looked like it was easy to get going. And I like that there's also a wide range of standard algorithms available in it. Any other thoughts around, are you guys using it in production or is it mostly for offline experimentation? Who's using it for training production models or scoring in production? Not much. So it's mostly used. It seems like most of you are using it for your model analysis and experimentation, but maybe not in your production scoring solutions. You all know R. It's great for DevBox experimentation. It's not really production grade. There are some companies out there that have provided solutions to scale up R, and there are also data connectors from R to Spark and languages like that. So you can get access to some of the big learning, large, more scalable implementations from R as well. Anybody using TensorFlow? That's a more than I thought. That's good, actually. That's great. How many of you are using it for things other than deep learning? Okay, you're all doing deep learning with TensorFlow. One of the interesting things about TensorFlow from my perspective is that while it's written for deep learning, it was designed with more general modeling in mind and designed with production in mind. They have some really strong engineers from a systems perspective on that team, and this is also their second generation of building deep learning platform. So the same people who built Google Brain have built TensorFlow, it's been my experience that the second generation systems are often a lot better than the first ones because they learned a lot about the scalability and maintainability of the code and the flexibility of code from the first implementation. Does anybody have any thoughts that they want to share about TensorFlow? What they like about it? What they dislike? What they wish it could do? Okay. How many of you are using, so now we're going to move on to some of the platforms. How many of you are using Amazon Web Services, AWS? Okay, so there's a good about third of the audience. One of the things about AWS is that you actually have a lot of options that you can tack on top of it. So you have a lot of flexibility with different machine learning solutions that you could use in the Amazon Web Services environment. Amazon itself provides Amazon Machine Learning. And right now, it's a little bit limited to training your models through a console or an API call. It does support regression models, and it has some good data connectivity, and it does provide some of these common kinds of feature transformations that you might want to apply. It does have some explicit limitations, for example, 100 gigabyte data sets. So not trivial, but not necessarily as large as some of you may need. And they have a limit on the number of input features currently prior to applying interactions or transformations of around 1,000 features. That said, I'm excited to see what they're going to do in the future now that Alex Mola has joined Amazon Machine Learning. And so right now, it's a fairly specific set of algorithms and a fairly specific environment that tools that it provides. I'm expecting there to be new great stuff coming from that team in the future. You can run Spark on AWS and have access to all of the machine learning libraries that are there. And you can tack things on top of Spark as well. And so a lot of the core developers of Spark are actually at Databricks, which has its own solution on top of Spark, which adds additional functionality and data connectors. But particularly, they've got a really nice notebook environment. They make it easier to schedule your jobs and do model deployment from a Spark notebook into a scoring solution. They also make it easier for you to help manage your Databricks instances over Spark solutions. Are any of you using Databricks? There's a few, okay. Another solution you can run on top of Amazon Web Services is H2O. They've got some nice scalable implementations of tree models that are about on par with what XGBoost provides. They have some slightly rigid deep learning support baked into their platform, and they got some extensive regression and classification algorithms. They do provide some good data connectors in it as well, and their platform is open sourced, but they provide support and solutions on top of that. And they also make it possible for you to convert your data from H2O frames into Spark data frames and interact and interoperate between H2O and AI. H2AI and Spark. So one of the things I mentioned earlier about a consideration is to consider the company and the maturity of the platform when you're thinking about risk. And so there's how many of you are familiar with Turi or GraphLab or Dado, right? So they've gone through an interesting set of transitions recently. They got really smart, high pedigree machine learning engineers on the team. They launched the company as Dado. They recently had to rename themselves. But they just in the last couple weeks, it was announced that Apple is intending to acquire them. And so I don't know what's actually going to happen to Turi after that. I haven't seen any notes around that, whether Apple will continue to offer that as a platform or solution. But be aware, like this is just one example. I don't want to pick on them too much. I'm not really trying to pick on them. But be aware of that these things can happen, and that can lead to uncertainty about whether a particular solution will continue to be available for you in the future. They do have some great support for notebooks and some really great implementations for scalable regression algorithms, and they provide some nice sort of templates for making recommender systems and things like that. And they also make it easy to use Spark from Turi. Are any of you using Microsoft Azure? There's a few of you, all right. They have a very rich competitive ecosystem to Amazon Web Services with pretty much all of the building blocks you might need for building web platforms. I haven't worked with it myself, but they do provide a machine learning solution on top of that that has both a notebook support and a nice graphical UI for setting up machine learning workflows. Within that, they've got some good regression classification support, also good service support for deploying your models. And they also are one of the few that provide pre-trained models for processing things like speech or images or videos. The other one in that space is Google. They provide some APIs for that. So that is one distinguisher that makes them a little unique. You can run Hadoop using HDInsight on Azure as well. So Microsoft Azure machine learning algorithms currently have some explicit limitations on the size of the data sets you can train on. But if you need to train on larger and you're already in the Microsoft environment, you can actually spin up a Hadoop or a Spark cluster. And the last one that I wanted to mention was the Google machine learning platform. It's in limited preview right now, but I think it's going to be one to watch because they're going to make TensorFlow and are working to make TensorFlow easy to use in that context. They have notebook support. And they are also the other platform that's providing some of the pre-trained models so that you can apply models that you may not want to spend the time training yourself to process content, text, you know, doing language processing or speech processing, doing machine translation and things like that. And so that actually concludes the overview of the different systems that I wanted to cover. And at this point, I'm going to hand it over to Yan. She's going to talk about how one example of a platform that we built at LinkedIn and how we chose to fit in the build versus buy spectrum.
Thanks, Paul. So next, I'd like to quickly share with you the platform we've built to solve a particular type of problems. So we actually started building this platform 3 years ago. The reason we want to build such a framework platform is because during our day-to-day life, we realized that there are a lot of problems that are about the same type. And our data scientists just repeat the model building effort again and again to solve different problems. So we think, like, why don't we generalize this type of problem and build a frame to automate the process to scale the human efforts? So here is the basic architecture design for this platform. It's actually pretty straightforward. We try to leverage the open source as more as possible. Also, try to fit into linking stack. So in the next few slides, I'll highlight a few key components. So first, we leverage Hadoop and Spark as the distributed computation platform, which is quite industry standard. And for workflow scheduling and management, we use AskBen, which is open source from LinkedIn. So from the previous tutorial survey, it seems like not many people has used AskBen before. There's an equivalent management tool called Uzi. It's also very powerful. So Madupa has a centralized feature mart. And the reason we want to build a centralized feature mart, I think Song Tao has mentioned about it in the previous part. So basically, our data scientists, each of them, they have their own domain knowledge in each very specific business domain. So if you want to build a model for your domain, but you may want to use the features from other business domain, right? Then you need to reach out to those data scientists or engineers to understand how to extract features from that domain data. We saw a lot of such examples. Then we decided to build a centralized feature mart. So all the data scientists can contribute their features to this feature mart. Once their logic got revealed and approved, then they can publish their features and share it with the rest of the users. So also, as Song Tao mentioned, we designed a metadata schema to describe the feature attributes. Basically, it could help data scientists to understand what are other features, other data scientists contributed. Also, our Madoop engine can, based on these attributes, automatically apply corresponding feature engineering strategies to each of the features. So the schema is actually pretty long. I cannot copy all of them, though this is just part of them. Then for machine learning library, we leverage LibLinear for the small data and MLlib for large data set. We also have an internal machine learning library called the Metronome. In addition to that, I think Paul mentioned earlier, LinkedIn recently open sourced a distributed machine learning library on Spark called Futon. So we will have a hands-on tutorial on Monday morning. If you are interested, you're very welcome to check it out. Madoop drivers is the key component, which try to connect all the building blocks into one workflow. So basically, they take the user input, which mainly contains the label location and the configurations, then it will automatically create this flow. So here, I give you an example. Like, this workflow is from the very beginning. We started to process the label data integrated with our feature mart and do feature engineering till we select the best model. Of course, for model scoring, we also have another workflow design. So the main idea is our data scientists don't need to do much work, but they only need to prepare their labels, and then we can automate the rest of stuff. Also, Madoop has a very easy to use web UI for user to provide their input, as well as to understand the model performance. So they can compare the model performance from this UI. Also, they can get the list of most important features selected by the models from UI. So the idea is for Madoop, we always start with all the features, then the model will automatically select the features for user. Then, but later on, user can decide whether they want to keep the recommendation from Madoop or they want to add features or remove features from the existing list and rerun the pipeline. So that's pretty much about Madoop. So as a recap, the idea is we want to scale the human effort to build predictive models. So we hope our data scientists can only prepare their labels, which toward their, what kind of problems they want to solve. Then within a few clicks, they can get everything done. So before we build this Madoop, usually it takes data scientists several days or even weeks to solve one problem, to build the whole pipeline. Then after we build this platform, then they only need to take a few hours. And they can later on find all the like models and also score the feature, predictive scores in Hadoop later on. So that's pretty much all about this tutorial. As a summary, here is a few things we want to call out as a takeaway from this tutorial.
Thanks for everybody. So as a summary, you can easily follow a pretty standardized model building workflow to build your production quality model, but build an intelligent model, scalable model with real business impact. It's just not about just follow the process. It's also a science and art.
And the takeaway from me is to choose appropriate evaluation metrics for different audience is very important. So metrics like AUC and F1 score might be quite common to use in research and development, but we might need to design special metrics or charts to show the results to communicate with our business partners who doesn't have those machine learning background knowledge. And second takeaway is a black box model is not enough. We also need model interpretation to communicate with our business partner and deliver the results to the end users.
And I just wanted to note that, when you're choosing solutions for your company, consider all of those different things we talked about, such as the scale of the problem that you have, the features of that solution, how well it integrates, the maturity of those tools, and how flexible they are so that you can support your future needs. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.